was trying to sound like T.D. Jakes. Somebody say look like T.D. Jakes. No. That's Travis. I know who that is. What is it, Travis? Cut it out. What is it, Travis? Tell me what's up. And Travis got to start dealing with God. And Travis, well, on Monday night, I'm going to be there Wednesday. Oh, yeah, I'm going to get up and let everybody know all the praying I got, concern, situation. I'm just going to let it out and let everybody. Oh, God going to say, oh, look, Travis, me and you. Praise God. So, and here's the deal about prayer. Prayer is just it gets you an avenue into worshiping God. See, God already knows what you need and who you are and all of that stuff about you. You're not bringing nothing new to Him. So it means that it's time for you to come into worship with your Heavenly Father. Mm-hmm. That's what He's trying to get us to, is that, and worship is just a form of what? Appreciation, recognizing, ascribing. This is you, God. I'm blessing you. I'm thanking you for who you are and all that. I'm glad that I am your child and all like that. You made provisions for me to be your. I'm glad for all. That's what I'm worshiping, coming into you with right now. It's not that, hey, Father, I'm coming to you. Hey, look, man, I need some gold down here real quick. I know you got it up there. Streets, just break up one of them streets. I know you got it up there. You know, I need some gold down here. You know, no. That's not.
I think another way to phrase it is prayer keeps you in His presence. You mentioned that scripture in Psalms 91. It says, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty." Well, if you're in my shadow, that means you're close enough for me to see what to keep check you out, see what's going on.
Mm-hmm. We have close intimacy. Mm-hmm. We're close. So and it's easy to worship. He wants to worship. He wants to ascribe to God, you know, just what He is to you. And that's what He wants, is for us to recognize who and what and why He is and what He is. Instead of, you know, we know He got everything. You know, God knows that too. So we're not going to be bringing anything new to Him. He just wants to know, are we sold out in heart to Him? Okay? So that's why He says, your Father knoweth what things you have what? Need of. He know what things you need before you do what? Even asked Him. So, He says, I'm going to tell you how to pray. Now, here's how you do it. Right? That's what He says in verse 9. First of all, you got to be qualified to say our Father. And it's a qualification when you say our Father, our my Father, our Father in heaven. And that qualification is Salvation 101. What is that qualification? That you got to be born again. And then another clue for what He says is our Father is that Christians do not pray, and this was came to me while I was at home. Christians do not pray with anybody else that is not saved. I don't know. I don't pray no Muslim prayer. I don't pray no type of organizational prayer. I don't pray if you're not saved and born again, I don't pray with you. Because it's just recital. Mm-hmm. 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 See, if Brother John would turn that off, I would tell you who else I don't pray with. Got me going all over the world. But let me put it like this. You got to be born again for me to be praying with you. That's the bottom line. If you're not born again, you say, well, Jesus is a good man, this and that, and He's a good prophet, that and this. Mm-hmm. But no, that's not good enough for me to be praying with you. And don't come to me saying you're praying for me. Going to join me in? No way. Mm-hmm. So I got to know that you are born again. so that you can say, "Our Father, Our Father." And then, what does it say? So he says, after this manner, pray. Pray like this: "Our Father, which art in heaven, holy you are." Holy is your name. "Our Father, which art in heaven, holy you are." Then he says, verse 10, keep this reality all the time. That we want your kingdom to do what? We want your kingdom to appear. We want your kingdom to appear. And we studied that this summer with Pastor Hill on teaching on end times. What's a good scripture? Where Revelation 11:15 says that. You might thumb to 1 Corinthians, the 15th chapter. Let's see here, talking about his kingdom. 1 Corinthians 15 chapter. Verse 24 through 26. Okay, it says, verse 23, but every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits, after that they that are Christ at his coming. So we want Christ to come set up his kingdom. That's our top goal right now, is Christ come set up your kingdom. Then come the end, when he should have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he should have put down all rule and all authority and power. For he must reign till he had put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy that should be destroyed is what?
Death.
And when he sets up his kingdom, you don't want to have to worry about nothing contrary to his kingdom affecting you on the earth. But right now, you have an inside knowledge, inside track by saying, "Father, the things that's operating in your kingdom, operating in heaven, I request that you bring them down here on my earth walk, in my earth walk life." Everybody on the earth is not sick, well, prosperous, peace of mind. Everybody, no, that's true, no. But in my earth walk life, I'm asking you, Father, to make it happen for me, as it is in heaven. That's how I'm as it is in heaven. And that's what Jesus has said. You keep that on the Father for you on the earth. Okay. Praise God. So his kingdom is going to come. I want your kingdom to come. Well, okay. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. And that is a key for walking victorious over the contrary things that's contrary to God's kingdom, is that thy will be done in the earth as it is in heaven, in my life. Now, is that bold or what? That's your right. That's your privilege. Father, let it happen in my life like it is in heaven. Okay, praise God. And in verse 11, back in the day, everybody worked for daily wages. Now we wait 2 weeks, maybe a week, a month, to get paid for payday. We won't wait that long for payday. But back in the day, when Jesus was walking the earth, he got paid every day. You worked the day, you got paid what that guy promised you he was going to pay you that day. So I got to have provisions. So Jesus was saying, just pray that God gives you provisions. Tell him you want payday every day. You want payday every day. Pay me every day so I can get my bread. Glory to God. But you're going to work. You're not going to violate stay at home and not be a worker. But you're going to be, because he says, if you don't work, you don't do what? You don't eat. But I got to have my bread, got to have my living. So give me this day daily. Pay me daily. So now we do stuff that we can, we can wait 2 weeks now for payday. Some folks, if you miss that next 2 weeks, they're out of action. Lost the house, lost the car, lost everything. Because it's paycheck to paycheck. Give us our debts. And then now verse 12, question to the class. Is this money, M-O-N-E-Y, or is this S-I-N-S? verse 11.
Yes, I am.
Sister said money. Is it money or is it sin? Forgive us our sins, or forgive us our money debts that our old brother John. Forgive me for that money I never paid back to Travis. Surely owe you some money, Travis. So what is it? Is it money or is it sin? What do you say, Candy? It's sin. It says debt there, but we got to have that translation right. Forgive us our sin. That's what he said over there in Luke 11. Luke translated it the right way, wrote it down, sin. So it's not debt. I'm not going to pray that, I don't have to pay this guy back. Now, he's not talking about money debt. He's talking about your sin debt.
Okay.
Forgive me my sin debt. Forgive me my sin debt. And who am I indebted to when it comes to sin? God. That's the only person you need to forgive you for sins is him. So forgive me my sin debt that I have against you, that you have against me. Praise God. Forgive us our debts as I forgive those who have sinned against me. Now, if you can't forgive those who have sinned against you, and Jesus gave all type of examples of that, where people are, I won't, you forgive me of my debt, in the four Gospels, and the guy says, well, why didn't you forgive that other guy that owed you some money? You want me to forgive you? And he said, no. So you got to forgive everybody else who has a sin debt against you in order for God to forgive you of your sin debt against him. That's over in the 1 John. Just turn there right quick if you can see here. Because I think I'm just being led to go to 1 John. Okay. Okay, don't have alt fight and all of that. Verse 10 of 1 John 3 and verse 10. It says, in this the children of God are obvious, are manifested, and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither is he that does what? Don't love his brother. Can't get along with him. Guy owed me 20 bucks, ain't paid me yet, bro. When I come to prayer, I just pray and thank God for how good he is to me. And, ooh, I love you, Lord. Hallelujah. Jump over, hang off a chandelier. But I'm still so mad at that other brother over there. Think my prayer's going to get answered. So he says, if you want God to forgive you, you got to forgive those other people. And this is in your secret place with God. This is in your secret place with God. Okay, so that's 1 John, the third chapter, deals with all of that, praise God. So forgive us our sin issues, as we forgive others who have sinned against us. And verse 13, does God lead us into temptation? Big question. Does God lead us into temptation? You know I'm weak on the crack pipe, God. Don't have nobody come calling me and said, Williams, let's go down to the shack and get some. They got it on sale. 2 for 1. Two pipes for what? I don't know what's going on. don't tempt me with the God. Don't tempt me with the crack pipe. Now the red light district. So does Jesus is praying for God not to do it? Can we say that God actually would do it if we don't pray for him not to tempt us with the stuff that we're weak at? Whew. Help me out, brother. Don't tempt me with that stuff. Don't lead me over there in the red light district. Well, Lead us not into temptation. What did God say, or what has the Bible said, the Holy Spirit, the Scripture says about God in temptations with sin? What does it say? Give you clues in the book of James. Now it might be, I'm thinking, James 5:18, could be wrong, but I'm...
Resist
the devil, and he'll flee from you. But what about God tempting? James says something about God tempting us. Does God tempt us with evil? God does not.
No more on us than he can.
He doesn't allow us to have no more challenges than we can bear. Okay? Now, does God tempt us? James 1:13. James chapter 1, verse 12. What's it say there, Candy?
Blessed is the man that endures temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to them that love him.
Okay, now who's bringing the temptation? Doesn't say so here, does it?
No.
Blessed is the man that when he is tried with temptation and overcome the temptation, but who manufactured the temptation? See, if we do it by our own interpretations and man's infinite, finite knowledge and ability, we'll say, well, then God did it. Don't keep reading on.
Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted.
God cannot do it.
Neither tempted he any man.
He can't do it. He just can't. He just can't bring no evil stuff to you and tempt you with it. All right. So Jesus said, lead us not into temptation. So it's not that God will do it. Jesus is saying, God, be on the lookout for me in case there's some stuff out there. The prayer of Jabez. And that you would keep the evil from me. And that you would keep the evil from me. Enlarge my borders and just bless me. Enlarge my borders and keep the evil from me. So just wherever I go, Lord, just if you see evil out there, knock it down before I even come around. So God has no evil in his tool bag to develop us.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, later on it tells us that you're in error if you're thinking that God's tempting you.
Yeah, you're in error. And so many Christians do think God is he's allowing me to be tempted.
Mm-hmm.
God allowed it to happen. God ain't got nothing to do with that. None of that kind of stuff out there. The tornado in Joplin. Man-made or devil-made?
Devil-made.
Now folks need to know how to determine the difference. Because your answer is coming to say God-made. I mean, God, what do you call it?
Act of God.
Yeah, act of God. So you say, okay, act of God. Blew my house, killed my kids, killed the cow, the car, everything. Just tore up everything. Act of God. Does God destroy stuff if he get mad enough?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You bet. You bet. Ask people at the flood. Ask Sodom and Gomorrah. Ask Moses. Oh God, don't do it, don't do it, don't do it. But how can you tell the difference? Wherever God is coming down with judgment, he'll first give the poor a clue.
Us.
Give the righteous a clue. Get out of the way. Get out of there. Mm-hmm. Get out of the way, Moses. I'm going to kill them all. Noah, get your eight. You and the eight, get out of here. Get ready. I only can find eight of y'all in the whole earth. It's not designed, determined to be whatever y'all. That ain't man. What is it? That's not man. That's not what I made. I got to kill that. I only find eight of y'all that's righteous. Get up, Moses. Noah, get out of here. Abraham. Abraham, get out of the way. So when God removes the righteous and then destroys everything else, that's God. When the devil comes in and kills the righteous, blow up the church, everybody else, babies and everybody else, that's the devil. He don't care who he destroys. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He don't care who it is. God, when he brings judgment, he tells the righteous, get out of the way. Get out of there. Okay. All right, that's how you know when, if what's the temptation of evil is all about. Praise God.
So there's no collateral damage.
No collateral. Lead us not. For thine is the kingdom. Your kingdom is coming. You got the power. You got the glory forever. And then verse 14, it says, so if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will do what? He'll forgive you. These are keys. This is prayer 101. And the thing about it, it's the basics, but it brings you into the big life. Brings you into the big stuff. Because you learn God's will, you know God's will, and you say, God, we've got to get out of here. God, I know you got it going on like that up there in heaven, and on my earth, walk, bring it down here like that. In my earth, walk. That's why it says if you touch and agree on anything on earth, and on heaven, on earth, I'll do it for you. I'll release it in heaven for you. Sometimes that's why I don't pray with unbelievers, because I don't know people don't learn, because they, well, Lord, if it be your will, if I be sick, if you heal me. If it be his will.
Man,
we got to stop praying. We got two different looks on what heaven is. See? Praise God. Hallelujah. That's it. That's it. That's the lesson. The hardest lesson I ever gave.